mnemonic. A mnemonic is a strategy to help memorize something. Think of overt, observable, obvious. Overt, observable, obvious. Got it? Covert, covered, covered. Can't be seen. CIA engages in covert activities. Not observable. They don't want you to see it. You, as a coach, must engage in covert activities. You cannot be there all the time. You've got to be able to manage and control the staff's conduct in your absence. How do you do that? Through the support that you provide, the material, supplies, and equipment that you have. Oh, here's an interesting one. I go to the house, and the guy has a spoon that's a right bent spoon. You all know about right bent, right? Because his cerebral palsy prevents him from flexing his wrist. When you eat unconsciously, you go like this. If you can't flex your wrist, the person's given a right bent spoon. So I go into the bathroom. What do you think I expect to be seeing? A right bent toothbrush, not there. So what do I see? The staff is brushing his teeth because he can't get the damn toothbrush in his mouth because they made a default decision. Now, you don't even have to know there's such a thing as a right thing. You don't have to have the answer. You've got to have the question. Well, you know he can't bend his wrist. That's why he has that. He's going to have to spend the rest of his life with somebody brushing his teeth. It's ridiculous. So, what are you looking for? You're looking for accessibility in the environments. This is a support issue. And remember, there's no requirement in the state of Arizona that any of your homes are accessible. And I guess none of them are. They're barrier-free, not accessible. So that if you have a switch for the garbage disposal, likely it's on the backsplash, not on the front. All right, as an example. As you can see, let me see here if I can do this. Can you all see, like, see my little red dot? See that electrical outlet right there? That does not meet accessibility requirements. It has to be right there. So that when homes are renovated or you build a new home, you always want them to meet what is called universal design standards. It's cost neutral. But agencies don't do that. But to whatever extent you can make a place accessible, adaptive devices are very important, even if you have to make them yourself. What about this? Sometimes, can you give me a chair, please? Don't hurt yourself. I don't have workers' compensation, okay? Thank you. If you can't see me, why don't you stand up here, okay, for a second? I'm sitting here and I'm someone you support and I'm eating. And this is how I'm eating. Right? See where my face is in relationship to my food? Now you don't have to have the answer to that. By the way, who's in this chair? Who is this?
Me.
Great. Now you don't have to have the answer, but you know that something's not right. So the answer would be he needs a plate riser. You're going to say, well, we don't have the money for a plate riser. Then use a stack of books. Figure it out, right? Or use several magazines. Or if you have a maintenance department, have them take a piece of plywood, 3/4 inch, laminate it, or put polyurethane on it, and put dowel rods in each corner, and then he has a placemat so he can sit in an upright position. Can you imagine having to spend the rest of your life eating like that? But I say that over and over. Maybe the person is like, oh, by the way, how does that happen? It happens usually because when the person was younger and they were learning how to eat, they were having great difficulty and their food would fall off their spoon. They would have difficulty maybe because they have an ataxic response or maybe their wrist would rotate and would fall off. And they learned to compensate by diminishing the distance between their plate and their mouth. Now that they may be more capable in getting it there, they're still habituated to eating like this. So by putting it on a plate riser, you maybe do that for a month or two, problem solved, plate riser gone. Or, with a lot of these folks, when I walk into a home and I see people eat, one of the first things I'm looking at is where are their feet. There are many people with Down syndrome who are short in stature and their feet don't touch the floor. And when your feet don't touch the floor, you have a tendency to pivot on your rear. So what do? You get a Rubbermaid footstool, they're ideal, somebody throws them to really light. And they're washable, you can put in, and what you do is you get two big rubber bands and you take the back legs of the Rubbermaid footstool and put it on the front legs of the chair and it'll stay there. So you're looking for relatively no-cost, inexpensive things to improve quality of life. That's what you're doing as a coach, the materials, supplies, and equipment. Now, in both cases, let's say you've never heard of a plate riser. Let's say you never heard of it, okay? You don't have to have heard of a plagiarizer. You see the problem that person's having. Now you turn to someone who may have that answer. Say, what can we do to help them get in a better sitting position, right? I lost my thing. Here it is. Okay. Adaptive devices, age-appropriate items, that's huge. And don't even go there with me. Somebody tried it yesterday, and all I'm going to say is, if you ever have me back, please have me spend a day with you on the whole discussion of achieving the right of adult status, okay? And don't just, I mean, it is the most provocative thing, but it's the best thing. Once we really realize that these are adults, we know how to give them options, and they have the things in their life that accelerate their adult status, then you're there. So that's really important. That's a big Achilles heel in many homes. But if I go into somebody's bedroom, and their bedroom is filled with, and it's a 30-year-old person, I'm waiting, 30-year-old person, and their bedroom is filled with stuffed animals and other toys. Is silent conversion going on? Don't say anything here. You're on. I go into, what's your name?
Kara.
Kara. There's a woman who's 30 years old, and I go into her bedroom, and it's filled with the things that normally a 4 or 5-year-old child would have. Is silent conversion taking place? What are we communicating to the staff? That she's 3 years old. Will that increase or decrease the probability that when the staff go into her room, will they knock on the door before they go in? They're not going to knock on the door. Absolutely right. Y'all understand what I just said? Because we extend a different level of privacy in our culture to children than we do adults. And when management has made the decision to surround people with age-inappropriate items, do not expect your staff to treat them with dignity and respect. Don't do that. If you're going to give them all these age-inappropriate items, don't be upset that they're being devalued, degraded, and dehumanized, because you've made that decision. It's a decision. It could be default. So, did somebody hear me say take things away from people? Did somebody hear that?
Yeah.
Okay, I just want to make sure, because sometimes people will, it's the time. Good, okay. Let me just finish this list. Individualized living spaces, that is huge. Probably one of the most important silent conversions. When you go into somebody's personal space, you should be able to know whose room it is. Is it a man, a woman, a little boy, a little girl, what are their interests, their hobbies, their sense of religiosity? Who are the significant others in their life? If you've ever had a parent or close relative that is elderly who was admitted to a nursing home, and it's really a really good nursing home, one of the things the director of nursing will tell you, would you please bring in some of the personal items of your mother? Now, your mother may be in the latter stages of Alzheimer's and not know or recognize anything. And the director of nursing will say, was she a religious woman? You say, well, yes, sort of. Well, bring in her Bible and bring in pictures of the grandchildren. Bring in pictures of the family. Did she have an animal? Yeah. Why don't you bring in one of the dog leashes? What did she do? Was she ever employed? We'll bring in some of the... And you as the adult child may say, but wait a minute. My mother's not going to recognize any of this stuff. What is the director of nursing going to tell you? It's not for your mother. It's for the staff. I want my staff to know that when they walk into your mother's room and they see the pictures of her children and grandchildren there, that she is valued and appreciated by people, and an untoward word and an inappropriate touch, there will be somebody in their face and in their space. And when you go into these residences that are void of individualization, it puts people at great risk. But those are the decisions management commonly makes. And don't be telling me about people tearing crap up and off the wall. Figure it out. Get Mod Podge. I mean, if the person likes certain things, get posters on the wall, get Mod Podge. It takes a hammer to get that. You ain't going to get that off the wall. You figure it out. You know, I'm serious. Everything has a solution. Here we go. Silently communicate that those supported are unique and special adults who must be encouraged to participate in all aspects of their lives. That's what we're trying to do, put those things in the environment. If I were to ask you before we go on break, on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being absolutely outstanding, 1 being, boy, we got problems, on a Likert scale, how would you rank the resident or residences, those places you're responsible for, in terms of what they're silently communicating to the staff? Would you give it an 8? Would you give it a 5? Would you give it a 3? What do you want staff to think, new staff that are hired when they walk in, about the people who reside there? That's one of your most powerful coaching tools, and that's our Achilles heel in our industry. Okay, guys, let me find...